When you think of a table tennis ambassador, Jean-Michel Saive tops the list. Making his debut at the 1983 Tokyo World Championships at just 13 years old, 31 years later, the crowd favourite is back. It is my pleasure to get to know the man that remains Belgium's number one player. Okay, so Jean, it's your 23rd World Championships here now in Tokyo. How do you feel coming back here after so many years?
Well, I still enjoy to play. I still have fun. Of course, when I played my first World Championships in 83, I could not imagine to be there again in 2014. But still my level is acceptable to be the best player in my country and to have pleasure. I'm here to try to help the team to stay in the second league and maybe to push them and try to help them to go up again in the first division.
Okay. So how do you feel about making the record? Are you proud of yourself?
Well, I didn't look so much the statistic. Of course, I'm proud because I have such a long career. So of course I'm proud of that. But I didn't. My target was not to pass the record. I guess the record was with Victor Bana with 19. But my feeling was just to go on and play because I enjoy. I wanted to qualify for the last Olympic Games, and in the meantime maybe I pass or I equal the record. And now, as I still have fun, I go on, and of course I beat, and now I have that record. So it's great, but it's just great because I have fun and I'm still able to play and to play on that level. So just to have the record and to sit and to play just 1 point behind the table doesn't mean so much.
So let's go back to when you first started table tennis. Tell me a little bit about how you first got into the sport.
Well, I started very early when my mother was pregnant. In fact, she was Belgium champion in double B category when she was pregnant of me. So this is, I always say, this was my first title, was a woman one. But then, so my parents, they were both players in Belgium. My father was number 10 in Belgium. So when I was nearly 9 and my brother 7, we started together. And then, we just kept going on. And when I was 13, I was already number 4 in my country and in the senior national team. And this is why I came in Tokyo in 83 for the first time.
How has it been growing up playing table tennis in a family of table tennis players, and especially playing alongside your brother for so many years?
Well, it has, of course, some very, very positive things because, I think for the parents it was also much easier that the two kids, they are doing the same sport. They shouldn't drive to basketball and one to table tennis, or one swimming and one table tennis. So for them it was easier. For my brother and me too, because we could also many times practice together. We didn't need some sparring partner or colleagues to practice against. And of course we were very, very proud and happy to achieve some very, very great result, like winning the European League, to be vice world champion in 2001, to be in the podium in 91 too. So for Belgium, which was not a country from let's say from table tennis before our generation, so we achieved some very good results. And of course to do this with your brother, it's together with your brother, is fantastic. But on the other part, it's also sometimes difficult because we have to fight against each other so many times in the final of the Belgium National Championship. So he was probably the second best player of the history of table tennis, but the best of the family all the time. So sometimes we had some pressure between each other. But okay, it was, as I said, the positive way and sometimes the negative way. But in the end, I think it was a successful story for both of us.
So there's a lot of rivalry every now and then between your brother and you. Do you feed off that from each other?
Yeah, I mean, we have to learn from each other also. I mean, I have one character, he has another character. Sometimes it was fantastic to play in the same team and for the national team together. Sometimes it was also difficult to play in two different clubs, for example. But no, I mean, my brother is still playing a little bit in Belgium on the national level, but also he organized some big competition, like he organized 3 times the World Cup. Now he will organize ITTF Legends Tour, so he has some other target as well. So I think we learn from each other in different ways. Now he finds his ways beside table tennis, so it's also great. But I mean, when we were playing, yeah, we had to push. I had to push himself to do some things, and he had to push myself to do some other things. But it was like this because we have two different characters. Yeah.
So growing up in Belgium playing table tennis, did you have to travel far for your trainings?
Belgium is not that big country, but you know, even if it's a small country, it's when you drive 20 kilometers, the people they think it's very, very far away. And when you say this to people who are living in big cities or big country, I don't know, like in Germany or like in Paris, just to cross Paris, it takes really long time. So it's a little bit funny how is the way of thinking in Belgium with the distance, but our country is very small. So when we started in beginning, my mother, she was the secretary of the club, and the club was maybe like 500 meters by walking distance. So it was also very, very convenient for both of us. So we could go there to practice nearly every day because our mother, she had also the keys. So it was very, very easy. And but then when I was already like 13, I moved to Germany to play in the second Bundesliga. And then, of course, my father, he had to drive me like 3 times a week to go there to practice and then to play the matches. So when I was like 13, 14, I started already to travel around Europe to play some matches and also around Europe to practice and to have some different opponent and different style of players, because we were not so many in Belgium.
How far would your father have to drive to be taking you from Belgium to Germany three times a week?
Okay, this was like 80, 85 kilometers, but so it's not that far as well. This is like 1 hour driving. But in the meantime, he was working like 1 hour away from our home in the opposite distance. So he had already 2 hours sitting in the train or even more to go to work in Brussels and then back home and then to drive us, of course, after school twice a week. And then we try to sleep on the weekend in Germany and then to play on Saturday the matches. So, okay, for us, when you are kids, you think it's like normal. But when you are adults, you know, and you realize that for the parents, it's not always easy to drive. And finally, you don't have so much, maybe so much time for your couple, you know, I mean. But okay, they did it, and we have to be thankful for them that they drove us. And then I remember they bought a minivan, like they do like in the big country, like probably in Australia or in America. And then we were eating and studying and sleeping there when we were playing tournaments, not only in Belgium and in Germany, but also sometimes in France, Luxembourg, Switzerland. So we were traveling in this minivan for a few years. Yeah.
So you would take the van to the tournaments and live from there when you're playing?
Well, not sleeping. I mean, sleeping in the when they were traveling.
Yes. But getting there
to getting there. Yeah, so we could sleep, and I had to do my homework for school also in the van. So, but of course, when we arrived to the place, we stayed in hotels. Yeah.
So you won silver in the 1993s and gold in the singles in the 1994, and then you've played every Olympics so far. What do you think is your biggest achievement for you personally?
I think my biggest achievement is to stay number one in the world ranking for 15 months in a row. I think this is, of course, everybody wants to win medal and want to win titles. But when you realize, oh, China was strong in the 80s, oh, China is strong, of course, today. In the period from 89 to 95, the Europeans, they were on the top. And for 15 months in a row, I could catch the position number one in the world. So This is something in which I am very, very proud. And when I look now the world ranking, I'm even more proud because I realize it was really, really, and it is really, really hard for a non-Chinese to be number one in the world ranking. Of course, beside this, I think the stronger tournament in table tennis by the quantity of the player is the World Championships, because there you have more Chinese than in the Olympic Games, especially now it's only two left, before was three. But World Championship silver was a great result also, even if I lost 21-18 in the last game with Jean-Philippe Gatien. And of course, winning the European Championships that time, it was the big fight. Among the European, we were the best in the world ranking. So winning the European Championships in the 90s, it was number one, number two on the world ranking in the final at the table. So it was really big, yeah.
So in your golden era of keeping 15 months straight for number one, what do you put it down to? Was it a mentality? Was it just being on top of your game at that point?
Well, I don't know. I guess in 94 I was really, really on my best performance. I lost the final of the European Championships 92, and then I lost again the final in the World Championships 93. And I was continuing growing up, let's say, in my world ranking and on my level. And in 94, I was really, really in my best shape. I think it's just pity for me that year was no World Championships or no Olympic Games, because I won the European Top 12 against Waldner in the final. I won the European Championships against Waldner in the final, and he's maybe one of the best, or maybe the greatest table tennis from the history. We won with Belgium the European League, the European Cup with my club. I won the European Masters as well. I mean, I had just a match ball with Gatien in the final of the World Cup, and this is the only big tournaments I lost in 94. Otherwise, I won all the big ones. So I can just only say that I was really on my best level. And this is why I stay 15 months in a row. Just, it's pity that was no Olympics or no World that year.
So you've been involved in table tennis for so many years, one of the longest, and you've also seen the game progress since it first became an official sport in the Olympics. How have you seen it progress, and what changes have you seen in the sport?
Well, Olympic Games is of course the competition number one for every sport. But in the beginning it was a little bit strange, let's say. Of course, everybody wanted to go to the Olympic Games, to Seoul. But I had the feeling that maybe the player, they were more focused for the World Championships in that time. I mean, for the first one. Or some players or some countries. And then after it became greater and greater and greater, and now you cannot compare if you are Olympic medalist or Olympic champion compared to world champion. It's much bigger, but as I said before, to be world champion, it's more difficult because you have more players to beat. Like you have five Germans, five Japanese, or even six in the individual tournament. So it's harder, but in the Olympic game, the pressure, it's much, much higher from worldwide, from your own country. So it's difficult. You see some strange matches in the Olympic Games, or even in the qualification for the Olympic Games. Some guys who play really good, then they are suddenly totally blocked by the pressure, by the stress of the game. So, but it's nice that table tennis became an Olympic sport, because I think we get back some a lot of money and a lot of help to help some other countries. And then because we are an Olympic sport, I think many countries, they get also money from National Olympic Committee to help the players to improve, to practice, and to try to qualify or to perform good in the Olympic Games. So it helps really, really much the table tennis world, yeah.
So going back to the 1983 World Championships in Tokyo, compared to now in 2014, what differences do you see from playing then to now?
Wow! Then it has to be a long answer. First of all, we play, I don't know by what I have to start. First of all, we play 21 points each game. Now it's 11. It's already 13 years, but that time it was 21, of course. We could play with only one color on the racket. So if you play with pimples and normal rubber, you couldn't see. You could hide the service with the arm. Okay, still some are trying to do today, but it's no more the case. Everybody was gluing with this rapid glue with organic solvent. What we had, we could use the towel after every point. Now it's every 6 points. Of course, we serve five times each. What was it more? We didn't play on Taraflex. This was probably on wooden floor. And then I don't remember in Tokyo, but in many sports halls, you had the line for tennis or badminton. You know, it was disturbing and difficult to watch good the ball. What was it more? Okay, we play with 38 millimeters balls also. I don't know, maybe I said everything. Oh, I missed some. It was made so many changes the last time.
Is there anything that has been changed that you wish was still the same as before?
Okay, I think the 21 points to 11 points, it's much better for television and for spectator because the game are shorter and there is more tension in the game all the time. Before, when it was like 16-4 or 15-5 and 17-5, then it was really long to wait till the end of the set. Of course, I always glue all my career with this fast speed glue, so I would like to have still this glue, especially that after 2008, many players had trouble to find a good, let's say, quality rubber to have the same feeling, same feeling as before. So this was the hardest changes. But I can understand with the if we want to have a clean sport, but this was hard. The ball from 38 to 40 millimeters, I don't think it was a really big changes. Maybe for television, but it's also hard to imagine that they can see the difference between 38 and 40. So, but maybe the biggest problem was probably the quality of the ball. Before, I think the quality from the 38 millimeter was better than today. So today there is sometimes some strange bounce, and then we miss some balls because the bounce it's not clean or not proper. For the rest, I think towel to get the towel, or I mean to use the towel every 6 points. I think it's just normal. Before you had players, they just go to take after each point, and it was so long and so long. To have Taraflex, it's also better because some holes we play also on concrete before, so this was, of course, unacceptable. So generally, if you see table tennis today, apart from the rules with the glue and water glue in 2008 and about this, but this is very technical, about this 4.0 millimeter, which brings some troubles among the player, which was not the case before 2008. For the rest, we have to see admit that table tennis grow up in a very good way, and it's more and more professional as you are here today with the media. It's also more professional way as it was 30 years ago. So we have to be happy the direction took table tennis the last 30 years.
So you're one of, if not the most experienced player here in Tokyo World Championships 2014. What do you see as advantages or disadvantages to being a mature player?
Okay, I will start. Disadvantage. Disadvantage is my age. Disadvantage is jet lag when you are over 40. It's really, really, really hard. Really, really hard.
How many hours was it to get here for you?
Okay, seven hours. And the last few years I didn't travel that much for let's say, official competition in Asia. And it's really hard the first 2-3 days. But of course, when you play so long, you are more experienced, you have less stress than before, but still you have to have still this stress, otherwise it's like you don't care at all. So you must have the stress, but you can keep it or control it a little bit better. You have, of course, more experience to what's happened. You are less fast, angry or nervous about many small details, what's happened around. So I think it helps a lot. And okay, mostly I'm here to help the young team because they have to improve. They have to find their ways to continue to grow up. And if I can help them to be on the bench or to play a little bit also for the team, it's of course good for them and good for me to keep my body healthy or try to keep my body healthy.
So your role for 2014 has changed from previous years. You're definitely a mentor for the younger players here, as well as being a great player yourself. What type of advice do you give to your teammates?
Well, as I'm a player, I have to have the behavior as a player. I'm also sport director in the French-speaking part in my country in table tennis, but in this position I don't take this position when I'm here and sitting on the bench. I'm here for them like a player, and I don't want to sit like a boss and to put pressure on them. I think it's good that they can see how still I can play, how still I can fight, even with my age behind the table. They have to learn how I was practicing strong, how I still can practice and play on that level, how I can still fight behind the table, because I never give up for any point. So I'm just fighting, and they have to learn to fight for each ball and practice hard. And okay, when you have such a long world championships by team, you have some win, some lose, and it's a long way. And even if you start bad, maybe you can play good in the end. And this is very important, to play good in the end, maybe not so much in the beginning. Okay, of course in the beginning you get confidence, but the best matches, they are more important, they are coming after 3, 4, 5 days, and there you have to be really, really good and really focused, and you have to try to forget what's happened, even if it was very good or even very bad, especially very bad. You have to be focused in the right moment. Now we are, Belgium is in second division, so they have to learn. They are very young, with one boy 18 and one is 20, one 21. So they have to learn all this and pass, win, lose, and then try to play good when it's the right time.
Do you have any hope for Belgium to be able to move up to the first division sometime soon?
Well, we'll see. No, we have to play tomorrow in Indonesia. We have to win first to be in the first three. And then, we won two. We lost two with Nigeria and Czech Republic. All the matches we lost were all very, very close. So we had today like 8 match ball in one single match. So. Okay, it's hard for them, but you have to pass this if you want to become a good player. And hopefully, as I said before, in 2 days, when the very, very important matches are coming, if they can learn from this and try to catch the right moment and to win one of those match ball in the right time, then they can win some important matches and try to be close as possible to the first division. Now our level, it's little bit hard to go up, but we never know. I think they have the level enough, if they play good in the right time, to be a troublemaker in the second division. And why not, if everything is successful, maybe to go up.
Who do you see as the most promising players, both in the Belgian team and just younger players coming through in the competition?
Okay, in Belgium, we have Cédric Nighting, we have Florent Lambier, we have Robin DeVos, Jean Loric, we have Julien De Herbeek. But two of them, they just got an operation, one in the shoulder, one in the hand. So we lose some time, and they lose some time now, 4, 5, 6 months. For Julien De Herbeek, his shoulder, it's pity, because he just qualified last year for the under-21 grand final world tour, so this was a good result. Okay, for Robin DeVos, it's another story, but I mean, Nighting here is playing really good. Just he missed few matches by very close. If he could have won this, then I think he could make a good jump in the world ranking and then get more and more confidence. Okay, Lambier is just very young, he's 18, but he nearly beat today one top 100 player, so he has to keep going and So, you know, the average level, I was calculating the average level from the player in top 50 in Europe is 31 years old. So we have to be also patient. It's not automatic that after junior you play directly good. It's maybe the case for the Chinese or for the Korean and Japanese, but in Europe it's not the case. We have to be more patient than before and hope that they win some good matches and then they get confidence and then they go higher in the ranking.
So table tennis has been a huge part of your life since you were so young. Did you ever get to a point in your career where you thought, I've had enough table tennis, I'm going to try something else?
Of course, many times. 2 days ago when I lost my first match. No, it happens, of course, many, many times in so many years. But, you know, never that long. Never that long. I remember once, I think it was 97, I was practicing with Vladimir Samsonov, and it was on Wednesday morning, and I was really tired, and okay, he was playing behind the table, and he couldn't push myself also, and then I just stop, I sit behind the table, and I say to the coach, no, I stop. And the coach, he came to me, he said, why you stop? You are still top 10 in the world. Of course, I was no more number one, but I mean, I was like, I don't know, 8, 9, doesn't matter. He said, but I want to stop. You are still young, you are 28. I said, no, I want to stop. I was like crying like small kid. And then after I realized, yeah, okay, what I'm a good player, why I should stop. And after, of course, in all my career, you know, you have always two ways. Why this guy is still continuing to play, because he's so old and now his ranking is not compared to what was his best. And on the other side, some people, they say, look how he's playing and still fighting. This is great. When I take myself, I sit on, let's say, on the sofa or at the beach when I have holiday, and after 3 days, I say, okay, do I like what I'm doing? I say, yes. I still earn money. Yes, I enjoy to practice. Yes, I enjoy to fight in the arena. Yes, okay, no, I'm 100 or 101 in the world ranking. Okay, I'm 44 years old. There is only 100 players in the world who are better than me. So, okay, maybe it's not so much reason to stop. So I just go on, because if all those points are there, it's good. Of course, if one day, if several days in a row I go in the practice and it's too hard, I don't want to practice, I don't want to fight, then it's really, really time to stop. But for me, of course, I have to accept also the target. The target is, okay, we play in second division, the target, it's no more the top 10 in the world, and my targets are much different than before. I have to accept this, otherwise I would be crazy, and I lose more matches, much more matches than before. I have to accept this also, but as long as I have some pleasure to practice and to play some matches, why to stop?
You show outstanding perseverance in the whole of your career, and also in every game you're known as a fighter at every point. Where do you find this mental stamina?
I don't know. This is in my character. I don't know. I'm coming from a small country, as I said before, not a big history of table tennis, but I realized when I was very young that I could fight with and compete with the best European player of my age category. And then I think it's just in my character, just to fight. I like the competition, so I like to fight, and I don't want to lose a point, so I want to win. And I think I'm a winner, I'm a competitor. I'm a fighter and a competitor. I like competition, so I think this is coming in my nature. And when I'm practicing, I always count every exercise in my head, just for myself, that I'm in a competition just with myself. So I think it's in my nature like this. Yeah.
Are you still learning new things about yourself as a player?
Yeah, about myself, of course, and about the technique, of course, also, because the game has changed really a lot last 10, 15 years. In my best periods, most of the players, they were playing, trying to receive short and then to start over the table with forehand, and most of the players were playing only good with the forehand side and not that good with backhand. Today it's mostly opposite. Everybody tried to start and to attack even on short service with the backhand topspin or banana or whatever. So the game has changed a lot. And about myself, of course, because it's, I mean, as I'm getting a little bit older, of course, I have to always to adapt myself. I can't do the same today as it was 20 years ago. I have to adapt my my way of practice, my way of thinking also, because it's not the same. So I have to adapt to all those changes we spoke before also. This was not easy, all this career. So, of course, I it's never finished. I mean, until it's really the end of everything, but it's never finished. You have always to think and try to learn different things, what's going on in life or what's going on in your sport career also, to pick up and try to improve things with your possibilities from the moment.
So table tennis, as your biggest passion, has taken up a large part of your life. How important is it to have the support of your family behind you?
Well, it's of course very important, because when you travel so much all over the world, it's very important to have your family there and to be stable in your life. Otherwise, it's really 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 hard. And okay, there is some part. It's not easy for everybody, because you are focused so much on your sport career and then you travel so much all over the world. So it's never easy, but I mean, you have to try to handle all this the best way, that that everybody is somehow satisfied, even if you are a lot of time away.
So, Jean, what's next? What's your next goal, or what are you aiming to do after these World Championships?
Well, I don't know. Now, you know, it's going to be again a big changes. Now we have the plastic ball coming up in the 1st of July. Nobody knows if we will get balls to practice or not to practice. Hopefully we will get balls. And then everybody has to see how you can adapt with this new material. So it's not going to be easy. Again, it's a big changes for all the players. And especially when you are older, it's even harder than for the other. Then I will see how I will adapt. Maybe it will accelerate the end of my career, or maybe I will adapt good and then I will go on, and as long as I am fit and as I have fun.
So do you see an end point of your career in the horizon, or?
No.
So you'll definitely stay in the organization of table tennis?
Well, in the moment, yes. I mean, anyway, as a player for a time, of course, and also I'm a member of different things, Athletes Commission in ITTF. Hopefully I'm elected again. I'm president of the European Olympic Athletes Commission also. So, I mean, I'm doing many, many things beside table tennis, and always with involved with sports. So I hope and I can bring more in sport than any other job, as I didn't study something else. So I think I can bring a lot of my experience for the sport, especially for table tennis, but not only for table tennis. I'm also in the board in the Olympic Committee in Belgium. So, I try to bring all this 24, 30 years experience on high level, 7 times Olympics, to the others. And hopefully if I can help 0.0001, it's already good.
So just to get into your mind frame, what is it exactly about table tennis that has kept you going and kept your career going so long?
I think it's because it's a game. You know, if you are a swimmer, it's really difficult. You are in the water, you just watch down or up. I mean, in table tennis, you can play young, a left, a right. You can always play a game, a match. There is a competition, and even if the time is there, I mean the age is there, okay, you can always find some pleasure. You change the game, you find another way, you count in tennis, you count in 11 points, you count back to 21 points, doesn't matter. You can have fun. If it's only athletic sport, it's really, really hard. I mean, if you see that you run, 100 meters in 10 seconds and then suddenly you run in 12 seconds, I can imagine it's good for your health. But to still compete with, or try to compete with the best, then I think you go really fast with motivation down. In table tennis, it's a game, so it's always new. Situations are always new. Doesn't matter your opponent in practice, in matches. So this is never two times the same. So I think this is why it helps to keep you going on for a longer period.
So you're an outstanding role model for players both young and old here at the competition. People have been mentioning you. What is your biggest piece of advice or a motto you could give to these players?
I think most important, you must have fun and pleasure in what you do. I mean, if it's just hard work and boring, you can't be successful. Of course, you must work hard. There is no doubt about it. You must work hard every day, and it's never done. You have to work each day harder. But if you don't have fun and pleasure in what you are in what you are working hard, then it's really tough to have a really long career. I mean, when I'm in the table, I practice hard, I fight hard, but I'm also smiling and have fun. Otherwise, it would be very, very boring. And I think if you want to be good, you must have fun and work really hard. And if you want to compete and to do it really long, you must keep this fire in your heart when you are behind the table. Otherwise, it's just boring. And this is why I just go on, because the flame is just there. And I have fun. And when the people they ask me the question, but why you go on and why? And why, when they come into practice and they see me practicing after 2 minutes, they know why. Because I have fun, I'm laughing, I'm fighting, and they see that it's just fun for me. So, and I just wish the same for everybody.
Thanks, Jean-Michel Saive. That was really great talking to you, and we'll definitely be following your next matches and the rest of your career.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Great. Cool, I'm thirsty. So